Okay, thank you very much for inviting me to this beautiful place. Today I'm going to show you something about our field studies on irrigation. So in most of my studies I'm trying to understand water flow and solute transport in the soil plant atmosphere continuum, and this for in order to increase the agricultural productivity and also important to maintain the environmental sustainability. Another goal is to improve the ability to accurately describe root water uptake under various environmental conditions, and the two conditions that concern us a lot are drought and salinity. Okay, when we wake up in the morning, we ask ourselves as irrigators many questions: why to irrigate, how to irrigate, and when to irrigate, how much to irrigate. And let me try to stop this cartoon. No. Okay. Okay. Delete. We'll stay with the cartoon. So, why to irrigate? Water flow from the soil into the plant, then to the xylem, and then to the leaves, and through the stomata they transpire into the atmosphere in the transpiration process. The stomata is the apparatus that assimilate carbon dioxide from the atmosphere, and if we want to maintain the stomata open, we need to maintain the transpiration process. The demand is very high for the evaporative demand, and therefore we need to supply water to the soil by irrigation in order to continue this transpiration process. So we need to irrigate. We don't have enough rain. In our region, I will show you later, we have about 30 millimeters, the region that I'm working and conducting my research, and this is not enough for most of for any crop. How to irrigate? In Israel, 70% from the irrigated fields are drip irrigated. 70%. Drip irrigation is the most efficient way to irrigate crops, is the most efficient in, by this that the highest crop per drop with this system. However, it's relatively expensive and requires manpower to install the drip irrigation system. The other 30% are sprinkler irrigation. We don't have any furrow irrigation in Israel, and any surface, other surface basing or strip irrigation, we don't have those methods in Israel, and we're only using sprinkler or drip irrigation. When to irrigate and how much are very important questions. With the same amount of water, you can produce different amount of yields if you irrigate in different frequency, for instance. And this is, I'm going to show you in the next presentation, four scenarios or four projects that I'm dealing with this salinity or drought or combined stresses. Okay, so this is Israel. Okay, this is Israel, and the place that I'm working is here in the southern part of the Dead Sea. There are many problems for agricultural productivity there. There is water shortage, the water are brackish, the electrical conductivity, the EC of the water is about 3.2 decisiemens per meter. This is groundwater, it's very saline. The soil is very heterogeneous and very stony. I will show you later pictures. And actually, it is not a soil, it's stones combined with the dirt. The extreme summer, the day temperature is 43, 45 degrees, night temperature are also high, solar radiation is high, relative humidity is very, very low compared to here outside when we have 95%, there we have 15%. Pan evaporation, extremely high, it's a hyper-arid place. 2000 millimeters per year. Imagine yourself. And the rain is very low. So we're facing both water shortage and salinity. Okay, so I'm going to introduce you a method that we developed in order to combat those problems of drought and salinity. In this area, there are many protected greenhouses or net houses, and probably we saw before that many farmers are growing bell peppers in this region. Recently, they are start to grow other things, but mainly bell peppers. This is a picture of the soil. It contains a lot of stones and also salinity. Okay, so I'm going to show you a solution for this problem of heterogeneous soil and salinity by doing or introducing capillary barrier into the soil. What is a capillary barrier? A capillary barrier is a physical state. It's existing when you have two layers, fine soil and coarse soil, and fine soil is sitting on top of the coarse soil, and you have this interface between them. So if you have rain and water infiltrating into the soil, the water cannot infiltrate into the coarse soil due to capillary forces. Therefore, if you have some kind of inclination, the water will flow to the lateral flow into the side. And we use it in many cases, not in agriculture, as we use in landfill cover to divert water from sensitive undergrounds. So if we have a sensitive underground, a polluted underground, and we want to protect it, so we can divert the water by introducing this capillary barrier. Okay, what we do in agriculture? In agriculture, we're coming to the soil, and we're digging a trench in the soil, and this trench, in the bottom part, we put gravel. Gravel, maybe 5 centimeter layer of gravel, on top of it we put a cloth, a plastic cloth, it's a permeable cloth. Water can infiltrate from the top part to the lower part. However, this capillary barrier eliminate most of this infiltration. We put sand on top of it, volcanic ash or other materials that are available in this region, like compost or coconuts. And on top of this, we put drip irrigation, and we directly seeding the plant in this cake. So the objective of the capillary barrier is first to increase water content in the root zone by disconnecting the upper part from the lower part. Reduce soil spatial variability. Of course, we are controlling the properties of the capillary barrier, and by this we're reducing the spatial variability of water content, and then the spatial variability of yield. And of course, another very important thing is to protect the root zone from salination due to capillary rise. In this region, we have a very shallow groundwater, and since we have evaporation from the soil, the salts accumulate on the surface. Here on the surface, it's very saline, but since we have this capillary barrier, it's also working on the other side, and water cannot go up with capillary rise because we broke the capillaries. So we did an experiment with the bell peppers. Here I'm showing the relative yield when we use the control and the capillary barrier. The control is the same pictures that we saw before, but without the gravel and the plastic sheet below the on top of the capillary barrier. We had 4 irrigation levels from 80% of the potential evapotranspiration into 2.4 from the evapotranspiration. So it's relatively a lot of water. And even here we see when we irrigate a lot or too much, we have a decrease in yields because of lack of oxygen and problems with the root water uptake. because of this. However, when we look at the capillary barrier, we see 20% increase in yields when we irrigate almost in all the range. So this method is proved to be good for farmers. How we do it? We have the tractor on a big scale. Yes, we have the tractor. The tractor makes the trench. Then our friends putting the gravel, and then we use this plastic material. Sometimes we use nets that the farmer took out from the roof of the greenhouse. We just use kind of the garbage. They throw it and put it in big piles, but we take it and put those in the trenches. And then we're growing the bell pepper in the regular way like the farmer did before. Here's a picture when we have very saline soil that nobody can do anything there and grow anything. And here we have the capillary barrier, introduced capillary barrier. And of course, we can irrigate here. And the plants showing that they're seeing only this volume. One problem that we have is because we have compacted root zone, we can have salinity from the irrigation water, and we are working on this. Another problem because of the low volume is a competition between plants. We're also working on this. So the artificial capillary barrier maintain high water content in the root zone and maximize water. And of course, when you have a high water content, you have high nutrient availability, decrease the influence of spatial variability, and allow the protection from the deep or shallow groundwater, and allow production in soils that would otherwise not be suitable for cultivation due to spatial variability, rockiness, impermeability, low water holding capacity, and of course salinity. So this was the first project. The second project that I'm going to show you is about the effect of climate on root water uptake reduction due to salinity. This is less applied. However, I'm going to show it. And if we look at the yield of plants, and here we have a salinity as the electrical conductivity of the saturated extract. So you extract water from the soil, yes, and you measure the electrical conductivity. If you increase the salinity, there is a reduction in yield. Plants suffer from salts, and the salts reduce the energy in the soil, and therefore it's harder for the plant to uptake water. So sensitive plants react very soon, and there is a very sharp decrease, and then you don't have anything. Tolerant plants react later, and the slope is much smoother. Okay. Not working. It is working. However, when we did this experiment, not with different plants, with the same plant in different times of the year, in the summertime or in the wintertime, with the same crop, we saw that we see the same effect. In summertime, when the evaporative demand is higher than the wintertime, much higher, we see the same decrease. And the chart is different. This is this is going very fast in the summer, very fast, and here it's much slower in the winter. So maybe there is something, we thought that maybe there is something in related to this effect of salinity and how plants react with the climate. So we test this hypothesis with this device. It's a carousel device containing 24 containers. Each one is a lysimeter. Lysimeter is a device to measure the water balance and the solute balance. So we can exactly measure the irrigation and the drainage below the root zone. And each one of them is located on a load cell, so we can measure the weight of the container. So by this, we can do the water balance and calculate the transpiration. Also, we can collect the drainage. We have a robot that can collect the drainage from the lower container, measure the weight, and also the electrical conductivity of the water. Therefore, we can conduct studies also of solute balance. We have a camera here that can take picture automatically. And of course, everything is done by a controller. And then the data is flowing to the computer and then to the internet. And I can sit in my house and see the experiment moving. It's rotating maybe one route per half an hour. Okay. So this is the cumulative transpiration over time. This is days. Every day you have the transpiration, and we accumulated every day. So for this plant we had 40 liters. For this plant we have about 15 liters. The differences are different electrical conductivities of the water, of the irrigated water. Also, we can measure the drainage electrical conductivity by this device. Everything is done automatically. And what we did is took this equation. This is from a Van Genuchten equation, Van Genuchten and Hoffman from 84. What this equation is predicting is the sigmoid chart from the last chart that when we have this decrease, yes? And the EC50 is the EC that produce 50% of yield. So tolerant plants have higher EC50 than sensitive plants. So here we have the EC50. We began with the 4, and then it went to 2, then to 9, and continue. So we plotted versus the VPD. VPD is here. VPD is high. EC50 is low, and vice versa. Made a chart, and boom, we have good correlation between them, and the transpiration response to salinity is indeed variable over time and appears to be affected by climatic condition. What can we do with it? A lot, because in Israel, in some places, the farmer gets both saline water and tap water or desalinated water, and the farmer can mix and decide the salinity of the irrigation water. So maybe the farmer can manipulate the salinity during the season. Another way to think is if we are working inside in a protected net house and we can control the humidity, for instance, or the evaporative demand. So if we decrease the evaporative demand, we can combat with salinity. Okay, another method that I'm using a lot is modeling. I'm modeling water flow and solute transport in the soil. I'm using the Hydrus 2D 3D model. It's a very known model that simulates water flow and solute transport, also heat flow, root water uptake, and many other processes. So, for instance, this is my domain. I'm simulating now a 1 by 1 meter domain. Here I have the water content in the domain. So this is 0.1, this is 0.45, this is dry, this is very wet, and my dripper is here. So what I'm doing now, I'm simulating. So the computer solves for me the situation in the soil. This is what happened after 1 hour. If I put a certain discharge rate on top of the soil, after 2 hours, after 3 hours, etc., etc., and I don't need to go to the field. I can do it in the computer. I can change soil. I can change the discharge rate. I can control system variables and make optimization in the computer. It's very hard to conduct it in the field, although we're doing it to validate the code, to validate the program. And what we did here is we took observation points, so only points in this domain, and compare real results from field studies. Those are the points, and the line is the simulated results. And we have here tensiometers. Tensiometer is a device that can help us to schedule irrigation. It's measuring the tension in the soil or the metric head in the soil. And when the plant was small, yes, the irrigation, here, this is the irrigation, it occurred only once in all those 4 days, and the plants grew, it irrigated 4 times during those 4 days, and the threshold for the irrigation, the threshold that those tensiometers are connected to the irrigation controller, the threshold was minus 40 centimeters. So whenever the threshold was achieved, irrigation was initiated by the computer. So it's pretty good comparison, not the best. We have here some problems, but it was pretty good, and we could continue for optimization, things that it was hard to do under field conditions. For instance, to do this chart under field conditions require maybe 5 years of study. And I don't have enough time for this, so I'm using the computer. In relatively short time, you can achieve these charts if you have a good model. So, for instance, I'm using different thresholds that initiate the irrigation, and if I want zero leachate, so that the irrigation will be the same like the transpiration, I need in this soil, under those transpiration values, to be in something like minus 40 centimeter threshold. And this optimization can be done only if we have a good model. Next project in the Arava Valley. As I said before, we have desalinated water and we have saline water. In Israel today, we are taking water from the sea and desalinating the water and use them for drinking. However, when the city do not need the water, water flows directly to agriculture. This is the sink for water. And Uri Irmiyahu and Alon Ben-Gal, my colleagues from Vulcani, they saw that there are deficiencies in calcium, magnesium, sulfur in the irrigation water. And we thought that if we blend, if we mix saline water with desalinated water, some of those minerals will come back from the saline water, because the saline water do contain calcium, magnesium, and sulfur. However, when you give back those minerals, you add also the sodium and the chloride. So it's not a good way, but you have more water. So again, we need this method to do optimization. We want to do optimization. What is the mixing ratio should be between the saline and the mix? So we did an experiment, or we are doing several experiments. Last year it was bell pepper. This year it's sweet basil. And in this greenhouse, we have those big lysimeters that can help us, again, to do water flow and solute transport. And we are measuring the weight of each one of them, and we're collecting the drainage water and measuring different the composition of the drainage water. And it's a very big experiment. We taking the yields and oven dry them and check the minerals. It's a very big study. We have 12 treatments with 3 salinities, the desalinated, the mix, and the saline. And in each one of them, we have 4 irrigation levels, from 1, which is the evapotranspiration that we measure in those lysimeters, and 1.5 in the desalinated water, so 50% more than the evapotranspiration. Here it's 100% more, and here it's 150% more. So if the plant did 10 millimeters per day, we irrigate here 25 millimeters, which is a lot. The rest of the 15 millimeters infiltrate below the root zone, with the fertilizers, with the agrochemicals, and can make problems to the groundwater. This is a common chart that we see from the lysimeters. This is the transpiration of those six plants that are grown in the lysimeters, and you see the differences between treatments, different days, and this is kind of data that we gained from the lysimeters. It's here we can accumulate the transpiration, and we see here this is the winter time, and here it's more springtime when the slope is increasing, and when we irrigating 50% more with the desalinated water, we get about 650 millimeters per season of transpiration. And if we want to gain the same transpiration in the blended water, we need to irrigate twice then the transpiration, which is a lot. In the saline water, even if we irrigate 250% more, we're not going to make it because of the salinity, and the salinity is pretty high there, even with big leaching, high leaching. We can measure the chloride concentration in the drainage, and look what happened. Okay. In the irrigation water, this is the chloride mass balance in gram per meter square. We have 1 kilo, almost 1 kilo of drainage below the root zone. Every 1 meter square, 1 kilo for one season. It's a lot. It's like to bring a truck of salt into the field and pour it on the soil, which is not doing good for the groundwater. Again, we can do this optimization using this numerical model that we saw before. If you are a farmer and you want, let's say, 70% from the maximum, 70% yield. In desalinated water, you will achieve it with minimum contamination of groundwater, and with saline water, you will have 6 tons per hectare of sodium chloride, for chloride into the groundwater. However, if you want to increase your yield by 10%, it means that you need to irrigate more. When you irrigate more, you pour more salt into the groundwater, 12 tons, which is a lot. So farmers do not think about it now, about the groundwater, but a time will come that they will need to think about it as well because of regulations. The last device that I'm going to show you, it's a collaboration with Ofer Dahan from our institute, the Water Institute. What we're trying to do here is investigating the direct influence of agricultural activity on groundwater quality. So we have this device, this slanted borehole. So we're coming to a greenhouse and we're making a borehole 6 inches in diameter. In this borehole, we have a sleeve that we're inserting into this borehole. In this sleeve, we have water content sensors and also suction cup that can collect water sample from the Vedo zone. The Vedo zone is the zone between the ground surface and the groundwater. And we can collect water sample. It's not an easy task, it's very expensive. However, we have water samples, and I'm going to show you pictures how it looks like. We come into the greenhouse with a truck, and then we have this making this borehole with a driller. We're inserting a sleeve, and then we're pouring into the sleeve a cement to expand the material and to make a good continuity between the sleeve and the sensors and the soil. And we can bring up samples from 20, 30 meters to the ground surface and take them to laboratory. We did this, we're doing this experiment in two different greenhouses. One is organic greenhouse, when the farmers is making when he's fertilizing the plants and the crops with the compost and the other organic materials. And we have a conventional or high precision farmers that are using a mineral nutrition that is using through the drip irrigation. So what we can see that in the root zone, maybe the 30-40 centimeters, the concentration of the organic agriculture or organic farmer is pretty low because of competition between the microbes and the plants, and then you see increase, and you can see that the on average is maybe 5 times more nitrogen than the organic than the conventional agriculture. 5 times more, it's really a lot. And organic agriculture need to give some answer to this high nitrate concentration. So of course, if you put a lot on the surface, you will find it later. And if you claim that it's healthier, they need to give some answers here. Thank you.